Thanks so much.
You know, we were just talking at the break about the all the concentric circles of trauma that radiate out from each of these horrific tragedies. And, you know, there's a path. There are concentric circles of healing that can radiate from each one of these families and individuals as they heal from all of this too. So we just wanted to send out a little bit of that in the midst of all this. We are living beneath the great big dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power, some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. I am alone, I am searching, hungering for answers in my time. I am balanced at the brink of wisdom, I'm impatient to receive a sign. I move forward with my senses open, imperfection it be my crime. In humility I will listen, we're all swimming to the other side. We are living beneath the great big dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power, some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. On this journey through thoughts and feelings, finding intuition, my head, my heart, I am gathering the tools together, I'm preparing to do my part. All of those who have come before me, band together and be my guide. Loving lessons that I will follow, we're all swimming to the other side. We are living beneath the great big dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power, some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. When we get there, we'll discover all of the gifts we've been given to share have been with us since life's beginning, and we never noticed they were there. We can balance at the brink of wisdom, never recognizing that we've arrived. Loving spirits will live together. We're all swimming to the other side. You can sing it. We are living beneath the great big dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power, some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side.
I've got to set a timer. If y'all heard me yesterday, I'm a hillbilly from Arkansas. I get a little carried away sometimes when I start talking. I can't help but tell stories. So I'm a 3-tour veteran of the war in Afghanistan. I did my first tour when I was 19, my second in 2002. My first was in 2001, about a month after September 11th. My third was 2003 and then 2004. That was all before I was 23. Obviously, I had some serious issues after that. I really related to a lot of things that were shared here today in terms of brother being different when he comes home, especially. I have a brother who's 9 years younger than me, and when I came home, he didn't recognize me. He even said, "You're not my brother anymore." I didn't really understand what that meant at the time. It was taking me a while to get to where I can grasp what that means. And I thank him for saying that to me. I also have a similar experience that was shared in the beginning of this in terms of mass wholesale slaughter in Afghanistan and picking through body parts. And that was very formative for me in understanding what war is and how it works and ultimately my injuries and what they are. So obviously, I have post-traumatic stress. If I didn't, there would be a greater issue here. And it took me a long time to get to the point where I could go to the VA and start asking for help, but I did. So what I wanted to talk about was that experience of going through it and making myself go through that, even though there are all these hurdles that we heard about today. So I volunteered for this program called Cognitive Processing Therapy, and to the VA, this is the Cadillac of treating PTSD. And it's basically in the title. What you do is you write like 10-page narratives, handwritten, of this one experience that supposedly traumatized you, and you do it over and over and over. I did this for about 3 months, once a week, all through the winter. And you also tell your story over and over. But about halfway through this therapy, Dr. J, that's what I referred to her as, I started to realize that I already do this. I've been riding my bicycle around the country for about 3 years now, playing music about the war and telling my story, and I'm already processing this. I've done cognitive processing. So I said, "Dr. Jacobs, I need to process something else because I've already done this. Can we do that?" And I have to say, hold on a second. She was about my age, and she really did want to help me. So she was pretty much open to most of the things that I wanted to do. I have to say that not everyone at the VA is a complete butthole. There are people who want to help. The problem is the institution isn't designed to address the depths of the wounds that we have. Like, PTSD is a reference to a fancy word that the clinical community uses to categorize what we go through. And it's based largely on psychological developments, you know, reactionary behavior, lack of emotional intuition or intelligence, polarizing situations, paranoia, the list goes on. So these are things that are used to look at mental health, but they don't really look at the soul and how the soul's been injured in war, and what that is. So I was like, "Dr. Jacobs, we need to start talking about my brain. We need to start talking about my soul, if you really want to help me. And I think this might help you help other people in the future, if you really want to help people." So, I talked to her about all these things I've been doing, riding my bicycle, telling my story, all these things I've been taking on, and how something is still wrong. Doesn't matter what I do. I've done warrior dances, I've done sweat lodges, I've done vision quests, I've done a whole variety of different types of energy works, and I've tried every single thing that someone will bring to me to help with PTSD, and I think every one of them helps in its own way, but there's no like one way to get rid of post-traumatic stress disorder. So I said, Dr. Jacobs, there is one thing that I went through that had a very profound effect on me, and I want to share that with you, and it's politically loaded. She's like, okay. She tried to steer me away from politics when I would talk to her about my injuries. I see them inseparable. I said, I marched with my brothers and sisters to the NATO summit, and I threw my medals back. And the act of throwing released something inside of me. I don't know what it is. I'm still trying to figure it out. But it played a role in healing my soul. And it was a very transformative event. And I want to talk to you about that. So Dr. J was like, okay, we can talk about that. So I processed this event with her. And afterwards we talked about how the VA could never endorse something like that. Because it's so politically loaded for us to throw our medals back, the VA couldn't say, hey, look, you need to organize a protest. You need to march to the Pentagon with 100,000 veterans, and you should just throw your medals straight through the windows.
Watch the Park Cities.
She's like, we can't do that. I was like, do you hear what you're saying? You're telling me that you can't offer me the actual healing rituals and ceremonies that I need, and an entire generation of people needs in order to heal their soul. You're trying to figure out how to heal the mind, and you're doing a good job to some extent with cognitive processing therapy. But where's the soul processing therapy? How do we take care of that? How are you going to take care of that? She was admittedly open to the idea, but she also said it holds too much weight politically. There's no way we could do something like that. And that's terrible. But I understand. And it's very likely that the VA will never be taking on that task. So I start telling her about all this anti-war work that I'm doing and how it helps me. How that's a therapy as well. Not just taking pills and not all these other things and biofeedback and all this great stuff that does help my brain. So I go on and on about this for a couple of weeks, and then one day I come in and I'm ranting and raving, I'm going on about it, and she goes, aha, I got it. I was like, what is it? And she says, you're obsessed with nonviolence. Having PTSD means that you polarize everything so much that you can't see from one side of the realm to the other. It's just in this tunnel, and that's all you can see. And all you can see is nonviolence. Yeah, praise the Lord. But that really got me thinking. I was like, wait a second. Are you telling me that my trauma, the very things that radicalized me, the things that gave me PTSD and focused my energy into changing this world, is what you call disorderly? Would you call colored people during the civil rights movement disorderly? Because they were oppressed for generations and had the boot of the state on their neck, and obviously, well, actually, this is documented. There was mental health facilities opened up all over the country to incarcerate black, angry men during the civil rights movement. Why are these black, angry men only able to see it this way? We want our rights. Maybe it's all the trauma you exposed them to. But what she did when she told me this was she opened a doorway in me of perception in order to see some of the things that are going on inside me and in this country and in this world. I started to see that my anti-war work in a way was me trying to heal my soul. And that anti-war work in particular is a symptom of moral injury. When you have thousands of veterans who are raising their voices and their fists and demanding justice, demanding that our stories are heard, you have, in my mind, all the evidence you need to categorize moral injury. Because there's a reason we quit our jobs. There's a reason we put our asses on the line to challenge the narrative of war. There's a reason we do this work. If we weren't morally injured, if we weren't traumatized, we wouldn't be doing it. So we talked about this for the rest of my therapy, what moral injury is and how moral injury works. And the fact that an anti-war movement is proof that moral injury exists. She had a hard time wrapping her mind around this. But eventually what we had come to was that trauma itself, in a way, is transformation, and that almost every single activist that I know, and the reason I do my work, experienced some level of trauma that mobilized them into changing the world, and that Western medicine likes to think that that means you're broken. So, as the therapy was winding down, I was like, I've got to sing Dr. Jacobs a song. So, I got really high. I got my banjo, hopped on my bicycle, and I rode to the VA and marched straight in her office with my banjo. I was like, I want to sing you a song about PTSD. It's called Soldier's Heart. And I wrote it this winter while we were working on this.
I just got off the Pakistan border. To get out of the heat. And my sergeant handed me some orders.